Welcome to the, I believe, third video in the series. So in this one, we'll actually go through a workshop of creating our own GPT. We'll fine-tune our first LLM model using H2O LLM Studio, which is a fully open source tool. So like I've been saying, you can install this locally and follow along, or you can just watch, you can just sit back and watch. Although there is homework where you will have to do the same thing, so I'd encourage you to follow along. Let's just jump into it, and I'll share my screen here. Cool. So if you want to install this locally, you can head over to the GitHub. Again, you can find a link to this in the notes of this video. But all you have to do is just scroll down to the installation recommendation, and you can simply copy paste these commands onto an Ubuntu server. You should be good after that. I've run through these myself on my local server. It usually takes less than half an hour to get everything going. But for the sake of this workshop, for the sake of this video, I'll be demonstrating this in H2O AI Cloud. So if you're a customer, you might have access to this, or you can reach out to us if you'd like access. So once you've installed and once you've run H2O Studio locally, you should be greeted by this screen. Here I can see my finished experiments, my failed experiments or stopped experiments. And I can get some overview of the stats of how the system is performing. Is it training something? How's the disk usage? How much space do I have left before I need to upgrade my SSD for more models? And you can see I can also get a list of my data sets. So for this example, I have only imported one data set. But if you head over to the import data set tab, you can upload your own. You can browse one locally on the server where this is installed. You can connect your S3 bucket if you'd like, or you can even import a data set from Kaggle. So you need to enter all the relevant details of the relevant section and you can import the data set. If you watched the previous videos, which I'd highly encourage you to do, you might have seen Data Studio, and this is where you can imagine it's really useful. But for the sake of this demo, for the sake of this workshop, let's just look at the Open Assistant data set. And let's go to summary. So here I can see that it's a list of about 8,000 conversations, right? And all of these are language modeling conversations. Now the thing, if you remember the pyramid from earlier, the thing about language models or chatbots is they need prompt and response. So they need instruction responses, which means they want examples of a conversation or questions and answers. Again, if you've used Data Studio here, you would already have a data set like this. But this is something to be aware of, which is that you need instructions and outputs where you have a question and a relevant answer that you'd like the model to learn on or train on. So you can see some of these have parent IDs, which mean these might be a part of a conversation going through loops connected to older messages, so on and so forth. Or these can also be the first messages. So example here, what types of tests do we have in software development? This probably is the first message, and you can read the response here. So as you can see, I get a single glance overview of the data set. I can go through examples. I can make sure things look like they should. Everything is good, and we can proceed from here. So again, you can import your own data set, but let's just proceed with this one. For the sake of the workshop, I'll click Create Experiment, and this should take me to the Experiments tab. But let's go back a second and let's look at our completed experiments. So here I get an overview of all of my experiments, and I can monitor all the metrics or the validation metrics, the progress, all of the different details. One thing I'd like to highlight here is that one epoch on this data set usually takes about half an hour. So contrary to common belief, once you have a strong foundational model, you can actually build your own personalized model in just a few hours. And in cloud rental costs, that's just some dollars and not even hundreds of dollars. So think in those, think in those parameters when you're looking at that looking at this stage. So once I hit create experiment, I'll have to select my data set. Here I only have one, so I can select the first option. So already identified the problem type, given the experiment a name, and selected a backbone for me. So if you've installed the software locally, you'll get a bunch of these options for yourself. You can decide which backbone do you want to start with. A place to decide which model to get started with is go to gpt.h2o.ai, and from this list, you can see which models we think are currently the best. So for the best performing models, I'd say start with these. But for the sake of this demo, let's just start with a smaller model. I'd say let's go with GPT-Neo just for the sake of this video. Now I can go through the data set settings, and here I can select the data frame name. I can set its validation size. So this is now 4%. I can make it up to 10% in this case, or you can slide it all the way to the maximum. I can select the sampling rate. So if I want to train on a smaller part of the data set, I can reduce the sample size. And a pro tip here, if you forget what any of these mean, and I might have paused and done that while recording this video myself, just head over to the info icon on the right-hand side, and this should show you what every setting is sort of corresponding to. From here, I can select different columns and relevant settings. If you load in your custom data set, you might have to load in or tell the system that, hey, I've used a special token, which might not be prompt. It might be, you know, let's say H2O or something like that. So that's just something to be mindful of if you're working with a custom data set. From here, we can move on to the tokenizer settings, where I can set the maximum length of the prompt. And this is the maximum sequence length of the prompt to use during training. Again, same thing for the answer. And I can enable or disable fast tokenizer. By default, always leave it on, unless you have a strong reason not to. From here, you can select the backbone data type, and you can train on integer 8, float 16, or bfloat 16. Float 16 is usually a good starting point. If you are tight on compute, you can go down to int 8. But again, all of this is just a simple menu selection. It's just a slider move. So as you can see, this is very convenient to set things up. You can set the learning rate, the batch size as well. And I can reduce the batch size to 2 in this case. I can increase the epochs to 2 as well. I can set my learning rate scheduler. So let's keep it at cosine. And I can set my warm-up epochs to the first 20%. So the first few steps will be warming up the learning rate. It will slowly increase. Then I can also enable LoRa fine tuning, and you should always do this unless you have a lot of GPUs. Always leave this on. And you can also select the relevant hyperparameters for LoRa. These would have been discussed in the earlier videos, so I would just glance over these. I'd say these look good, so I can move on further. From here, we get some augmentation settings and prediction settings. So I can set the metric to the blue score in this case. And again, I can set the minimum inference and maximum inference length. At this point, I'm quite happy with all of the settings, and you can probably read through them once more for a sanity check, or at this stage, you can click run experiment. So this will kick off an experiment where everything will sort of start to happen. And let me show you what things will look like once the experiment launches. You'll get a relevant overview of everything you care about. And in real time, you can also monitor where your model is performing the best. Where is it giving good answers? Where is it giving the worst answers? This can help you possibly iterate on your data set, or maybe go with different settings for fine tuning. So again, always go to these. Validation tab would be a strong suggestion. Also, once the model is trained and when your GPU is not being used, you can chat with the model to really get a feel of how it behaves in certain scenarios. So this is a setting that we're quite proud of as well. And once you've done that, you can probably push your model to Hugging Face as well. So once you've connected your API key and your account, all you have to do is export, and this will upload your entire model with the model card populated to Hugging Face, to your Hugging Face profile. And I think this is really great if you want to share these models, or if you're just training a lot of models in the wild. So this was an overview of LLM Studio. We let this experiment run for about the few minutes it will take. But at this point, I've shared all the settings that you might care about when fine-tuning your own GPT. Remember, it's always important to start with a great data set. So here I've loaded in Open Assistant. But if you have access to Data Studio, I'd say start with that, or find a data set that you might care about. Hugging Face is a great starting point, which will lead me to the next video, where I'll sort of help you set up the assignment, and we'll give you some pointers, not everything. I won't give you the entire answer, but some pointers for getting started with the assignment.